Okay, this is the first lesson on economic growth. But previously, the first video we did was on trade-offs. And if you can remember that, the biggest trade-off in the whole system was the old Phillips curve, which said there was a clear trade-off between inflation and unemployment. But then we have the monetarist idea, which is the long-run Phillips curve, and the way in which we can explain this because of money illusion and everything else moving from A to B to C. And then we also looked at the monetarist argument, which is neoclassical free market believers, which is this diagram here, which is whereby if you increase AD, that will always lead to a rise in inflation. We also looked at the causes of unemployment. Remember, one, there's real wage unemployment, and this will occur when the minimum wage is above the equilibrium price. So wages are not allowed to fall. So therefore, you get real wage unemployment in that situation. But there are lots of different types of unemployment. Structural, frictional, cyclical, seasonal, real wage unemployment, occupational, geographical immobility, problems with inflation, you lose your international competitiveness, problems with deflation, if it's bad deflation, benign deflation, lack of demand in the economy, therefore people stop spending money. You cannot decrease your interest rate. Well, you can increase your interest rate below zero, but if you've got minus 2% inflation, then even if your interest rate is zero, in a way, you still have a 2% interest rate in real terms. Problems of unemployment, private costs and social costs. And then we have MV equals PT, causes of unemployment and causes of inflation. Right. So this was the whole 32-minute video, which you watched previously for week one. Right. This one now we're going to be looking at economic growth. Economic growth up here, then why is economic growth a good thing? And also, how can we avoid conflict between inflation and unemployment? Clearly, the answer is supply-side economics, neoclassical, or even on the Keynesian model from there. Right, other potential conflicts is growth in the environment, growth and inequality, reducing government debts but increasing inequality, growth in the balance of payments. As we grow more, then the balance of payments will get worse. Inflation and the balance of payments and growth and inflation. However, if you use supply side or free market supply side or intervention supply side, then this may not occur. Okay, so this one's all about economic growth. And remember, trust arguments, growth, 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 key part of the policy. And on here, these are the advantages of economic growth. Things like higher incomes, you pay off your national debt, kicks off the multiplier accelerator, more investment for the green economy, money can be spent on the environment, more investment anyway, research and development, economic development, not just economic growth, more choice, and a decline in absolute poverty. So the whole of trust argument is make the cake bigger. Okay, we all get a bigger slice, but everybody gets a bigger slice, even though the poorest in society will get a very small increase, at least they will get an increase. Okay, so we need to know those. Anyway, trustonomics was based upon the free market model. Then evaluation of economic growth. Yes, economic growth is really important, particularly in less developed countries, because it brings people out of poverty. However, economic growth could also harm the environment, obviously pollution and climate change. And it also depends on how they distribute that money. Do they give it all to the rich or whatever? Diminishing marginal utility of growth. What that means is if we take the UK, even if we get growth and the rich become even richer, there's a diminishing marginal utility. Does it really make them that much happier? In fact, in the UK, they found, as I often repeat, that the top wage to get is £50,000 a year. That is the happiest wage that you can get. Then we've got the diagrams, negative output gap, positive output gap. Thanks to Thomas Smythe on this one. We've also got this diagram. We can have a negative output gap here and a positive output gap on here. So we can show those both on one diagram. I'm sure you will know these other diagrams on it. So that's evaluating economic growth. Remember, it is a bit of a raw indicator, as we will find out as we go through the rest of the course. Okay. There is no conflict with supply side economics. Intro, free market interventionist. So I've written this essay for you. This is contained in the booklet, which is here, and that's on the back of the booklet. And there's an essay on there. There is no conflict with supply side economics. So is it free market or is it interventionist? Intro, paragraph one, free market, labour market flexibility, why that works, pushes out the S-curve, more enterprise, more investment, maybe lower wages, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, yeah, we got that one on there, but it could lead to a rise in inequality, which is the however on this one. Paragraph two, low corporation tax. Bog standard piece of theory, really. Low corporation tax. That might conform to the Laffer curve. It might, it may not. So there might be an increase in national debt, but hopefully that will create more growth within the economy. Paragraph three, interventionist, increasing G, EG, but a green energy revolution. But however, national debt would go up. Conclusion, labour market flexibility, more inequality, the Monetarist argument that there is no conflict in the long term with suppliers and economics. But what happens if there's a demand side shock? We're still going to need some demand in there. Okay, 2008, 2009 and 2020. Okay, next bit on to interesting articles that I've also put in the middle of the booklet. Right, we have in the UK a consumption-led economy. This is not the sort of economy that you want, because by consumption-led economy is we buy more imports and also eventually people get into personal debt. In the UK, personal debt is 400% of GDP. National debt is 100% of GDP. What you really want is export-led growth. However, think about it. Not every country in the world can have export-led growth, because some countries, by definition, if China's £100 billion trade surplus, then some other country must have £100 billion trade deficit. Remembering in the UK, we've had 1 year of the last 30 where we've had a trade surplus. Then the other article is, it talks about austerity. Was it the right idea? They argue that it wasn't. A lot of our current problems are because we had austerity. Okay, they slashed the National Health Service, the railways, etc., etc. So did it work? During this time, we could have borrowed loads of money because borrowing money was really cheap and we could have restructured the British economy. But at that time, George Osborne and his government decided to go for export-led growth, which is what they failed in, and also they tried to cut the national debt, which they also failed in. However, right, we did have austerity. Right, Kwasi Kwarteng, our shortest ever Chancellor Exchequer, sadly not. I think one of them died in office as well, but he was there for less than 44 days, less than a lettuce, right? But he talked about stagnating and anemic economic growth. Now, if you look at the stats, ever since the year 1990, over every 5 years, we've always had lower and lower growth. So their idea was to change all of this round. It didn't quite work out. In 2010, we missed a trick. But in 2023, we need to have some structural reform in the economy. Right, this one on here, circular flow of income. Right, this is just saying, this is about injections and withdrawals going out of the economy of saving taxes and imports, and going into the economy, increasing investment, government spending and exports. Okay, if the injections are more than the withdrawals, then your equilibrium will change. It will in fact go up. So we could effectively borrow loads of money, increase G, and therefore we could get some economic growth out of that. The only problem is we would have national debt. Okay, so this is this model on here. Households will get off of their labour, they get incomes, they then spend money, and in return they get goods. Right, but there's this idea here of equilibrium in the model, is when injections are equal to withdrawals. But in the UK, as we all know, we have a trade deficit, so this puts downward pressure on AD. However, what we've done is, to survive, in a sense, we've had budget deficits and consumer debt to make sure that our demand is still high enough. If you look at your notes, I'll talk you through this in the lesson. Expenditure equals output, which equals income. Okay, equilibrium is where W is equal to J. The next part of the course, quite a small part of the course, but I have seen essays on this, and I put one essay in the book, is AD equals C plus I plus G plus X minus M. The question was, what happens if savings fall? Okay, well, if savings fall, basically then we're spending more, which increases AD. That could be bad, because it could create demand pull inflation, could create a worsening balance of payments. It could be banks have less money to lend out to firms, so there's a shortage of funds available, so therefore they're going to put the interest rates up on those particular things. So that was an essay. And also, what factors influence consumption? Common sense. What factors influence investment? What factors influence government spending? And what factors influence exports on there? So consumption will be like, what level the interest rate is at, how many people have jobs, how confident people are in the future, then people will tend to spend more money. Okay, pretty obvious stuff. And then also in there, we have the perfect paragraph, crowding in, where you increase G, more demand in the economy. So there's more demand in the economy, therefore firms invest more. Therefore, the AS curve will go out and there'll be more funds available. So there'll be more funds within the economy. They're crowding out, which is what everyone believes in, which is what also what the Bank of England probably believes in, the crowding out theory. And I've given you in there the perfect paragraph in there. Okay, next one on here, crowding out. If we increase G, therefore we've got to sell more bonds. If we sell more bonds, then the consumers buy bonds. Therefore, the consumers do not buy shares or do not put the money in the bank. So therefore, there's less money available for the private sector. And then the government spends the money. And because we've got really inefficient government, then we will waste that money. But we've also taken the money away from the private sector. So therefore, we need to make the government sector smaller and stop the crowding out effect. But basically, fundamentally, is we are taking money away from the private sector. A good candidate will be able to write this out. Okay, but you know, you all know that I believe in the crowding in effect, which I think is a much more powerful idea. Determinants of long-run aggregate supply. How can we shift out the long-run aggregate supply curve? Technology, productivity, attitudes, enterprise, factor mobility, economic incentives, and the role of the banking system. Right, if banks do not lend out to firms in the real economy, then our economy will suffer. And that's also been a bit of a debate that we've been having. Right, but all of these factors here will shift out the long-run aggregate supply curve. So what we've covered so far, we've covered the monetarist view. I spent absolutely no time at all on industrial strategy, industrial policy, which is also on the syllabus, Mariana Mazzucato, which is basically you have an industrial policy, providing grants for business, giving businesses advice, having a general direction for the economy. In Mariana Mazzucato's phrases, you create markets. So therefore, we should have created the market in green technology. And that would have been a good idea because we want to stop climate change and we will become market leaders in that. And that's a government working with the private sector. Okay, consumption-led growth and also the environment on there. Okay, uses of national income data. Ah, or how useful is it? There are various weaknesses with national income data. Purchasing power parity, which is a pound in Namibia is worth much more than a pound in the UK. So if the average income in Namibia is 2,000 quid and the average in the income is in the UK is 30,000 quid, that does not mean that we are 15 times richer than the people from Namibia, because their 2,000 quid will probably go further. Economic activity not measured, e.g. subsistence farming in Namibia, will not be part of that process. Externalities of growth, you all know this, pollution, freedoms, hours work, poverty. Now, in the UK, we're not doing very well on this because we have a lot of externalities within the UK, as actually, to be fair, most developed countries. We work harder in the UK than other countries. 20% of the population is in poverty, one in five people. We do have a lot of liberty and freedom, unlike some countries. So if you're a lesbian or gay in Qatar, it's probably not the best place to go on holiday. Literacy and also living standards. Living standards is a much broader term. So this is a criticism of real GDP per capita as an indicator of growth and how well our economy is doing. Okay, but I find it easier to be a little bit more extreme than this is to look at the Human Development Index, which is also on the syllabus, which is about life expectancy, knowledge, and also incomes. There's another one which is not on the syllabus, which is the Index of Sustainable Economic Welfare, which is as your real GDP per capita goes up, actually, we have not become richer. This line here, not very clear on here, has actually gone down. This is because the Index of Sustainable Economic Welfare takes into account inequality, education, climate change, etc. So this is, say, America up here. We can say over time that the real GDP has gone up, but actually, according to this measure, right, it's actually gone down because we have less freedoms. There's more poverty than there was maybe in the past. Okay. Happy Planet Index, not on the syllabus. However, it did want to come up. So it is well-being times life expectancy and ecological footprint. The person who devised this, he did a TED talk on this. When he devised this, this made an awful lot of money. Okay. Boom, boom, boom. Well-being, life expectancy. In terms of the Happy Planet Index, Costa Rica became the number one country in the world. I think it's just nice and easy to remember. And it's a criticism of the economic growth. So why don't we move to the Happy Planet Index, which is a bit more about happiness, well-being, life expectancy, and how much do we damage the environment a lot. So HGOs are on the syllabus, index of sustainable economic welfare, and I'm just going to do this for a bit of a joke on here. I don't know, this, the camera is really close to me, and the Happy Planet Index. I'm just going to play a bit of music on here. I'm gonna move it on a second. Have you planet index? This is the bit!
Lifting.
Yeah. We can be lifting all the shadows. Lifting out of the way. Thank God for that.